This is Michael Powell from Nerd Reactor. We just got out of the BioShock Infinite demo. And this is...
Sean Robertson, lead artist at Irrational.
Very cool. One of the first things I noticed while watching the demo was Elizabeth, the female protagonist, had kind of a time-traveling ability. She was able to take herself and the main character into more of a modern world setting. And then later on, able to bring objects from different time periods into her current setting. How does that play into the game?
Well, from a gameplay perspective, there's these tears that the player and Elizabeth can see throughout the world. Not only Elizabeth can actually manipulate the tears, but she will do that when Booker asks her to. So when the player needs to bring something in that's of gameplay relevant, he can get Elizabeth to do that for her. Now, she has a limited amount of power, so she can't bring in everything that you see. So you have to make tactical choices on the playing field of what you want to bring in to help you at that time.
Okay. I also noticed that in the gameplay, Elizabeth offers the player choices that will let them either go be up to the big baddie or go get more supplies.
Yep.
Will choosing certain branches affect storyline gameplay later on?
Now, we don't want to go too deep into the details as far as like narrative and affecting narrative throughout the game. I mean, there's definitely a story arc that we're trying to tell, but there are decisions that you can make that will affect gameplay either immediately or a little later on down the road, but I don't want to get too specific about how exactly that will play out.
Okay. Also, in previous BioShock games, you were able to use splicing abilities to basically mutate yourself. In this one, it's a little bit different. Can you tell us how the main character got this ability and how he's going to be able to use them?
You're talking about the vigors that the player can use to enhance their capabilities, like the Murder of Crows, where you can throw crows out. It's similar to the plasmid system in BioShock 1. There are some changes that we're going to do to it. Again, more on that down the road a little bit. But this time around, we still do give that tool to the players to use. And again, it's part of expanding the player's tool set to let them play through the game as they want to, as they choose to.
Very cool. I also noticed that the Somber here, there are elements from the Big Daddy, here and there. Is there any other influences that affected you in your choice of the character design of this giant bird robot thingy?
It's funny, we were struggling with creating this character, and Rob Waters, one of our concept artists, drew this character with Elizabeth reaching up to touch him, and it was just a really rough sketch. But the minute we saw that, we're like, "This is the guy! This is the character that we want to create."
Okay, and also the costumes that the bad guys were outfitted in. How much research did you take into researching the historical value of each and every outfit or anything? Can you tell us a little bit about the process?
Yeah, we love going back to the source when it comes to these things. When we were thinking about making a game 1900, 1911, we're looking at pictures at the time, not only for the characters and the costumes that they're wearing, look like, what does a carriage look like at that time period. So we draw a lot of reference and inspiration from going to source material.
I also noticed you have airships and all that stuff, kind of a borderlines on steampunk, kind of a steampunk technology, steampunk art. Can you tell us a bit about that?
We don't really like to put a label on what we're doing yet. Like, our true influences, like I said, come from the source. Like, we like to go back to looking at these photographs from that time period and drawing our inspiration from that. So we don't really have it in our mind that we're trying to nail one style or another. We're just trying to create a style that's unique to our own.
Okay, very cool. And did it take the original two BioShocks? It was more of a, kind of a deco noir look. This was more of a, kind of a little bit of a Norman Rockwell, turn of the century, that type of thing. Can you tell us about, your guys' decision about using the look?
Yep. When we first started playing around with City in the Sky, it was a very dark sky. The clouds were close in. We even had that greenish tinge to it, and it felt like you were under the ocean. And we started pushing the clouds back until we arrived at, the 4th of July blue sky. So it wasn't something that we came to overnight. It was something that, was a long process involving a lot of people on the art team.
Oh, very cool. And also, last question. Before, in the first two BioShocks, you're basically playing kind of a faceless person, you know, who really didn't have a voice of own. This one, you guys actually had a character created, a person actually voicing the character. How was writing for that and designing the characters and all that stuff like for you guys?
Well, Ken Levine's the one that's actually writing the character, so that's a question better suited for him. I mean, it's from a narrative standpoint, you know, we're telling a story. We decided that this time around, with the story we wanted to tell, that we wanted you to be a character that you could recognize, and it had a past that we could tie into the story.
Very cool. Thank you. I'm excited for the game. I know a lot of people out there are really excited for the game. Thank you for taking time from your busy schedules with you having a little interview with us.
All right, thank you.